I've had a brief look through the exhibition. I had arrived here with plenty of time to take it in great detail, but there were too many stories to be told or allow me to do it. The works that we've seen here today really give us a rare window into the past. They speak of a horrific time in the history of the world, but they also illustrate the strength and beauty of the human spirit and the transformative power of art. And although we were although the artists that were exhibiting here today, Paul Schwartz and Leo Lovett, were undoubtedly uncertain and fearful of their future, what lay ahead of them, they were compelled to make this art in the camp, whilst they were in the camp. And you look into, you look behind some of the colours that are there, particularly in Schwartz's work, and you can see there are very detailed messages, detailed descriptions of what the life was like, and I think they're an important part of world history, and we're so lucky to have them here in Melbourne. The artists there were compelled to seek meaning in the world that surrounded them. And when you look at these pictures, you see the Jewish Holocaust experience. But we also get a snapshot of daily life of the Jewish community. It's a small piece of Jewish art history, but it speaks volumes, especially today. And I'm really glad that the museum has decided to bring this exhibition back for us all to see after being first exhibited about 20 years ago. In presenting Freudenstadt, the Jewish Museum is really encouraging us to reflect on the past, to remember the suffering and to embrace sometimes the rare moments of beauty that existed at that time, the courage, the sense of community. My job, as I said, is to officially open this exhibition. And I can't help but revealing to you what a moving commencement to the day was with the lighting of the candles from the survivors. I found it a very powerful part of today's proceedings. It's personally very emotional to me, and I can't imagine how emotional it was for the survivors, and I thank each and every one of you for being here and allowing us to join in your experience. So thank you once again.
And we're back.
And we're talking about music of
yes.
all types. But
and
before
we
start,
we have a guest.
We have a guest, George, Cass, welcome to the show. Before we talk about stuff you're doing now, what instrument did you play when you were young? What did you learn?
I learned a little bit of piano, but I didn't pursue it.
Because?
Busy with other
talentless
things.
Talentless or busy?
No, just busy with other things. But, no,
but you were young?
Piano. Yeah, when I was about five.
What were you busy with?
Good answer.
School.
Okay, and you, what did you play?
I played, I think, I'm not sure if it was a Donne or a Dunlop, but it was...
You played the tennis racket.
I played the tennis racket, oh. Yeah.
We did a lot of tennis
good.
Play.
And I used to bash... We
it's
had
called
a piano.
Air guitar.
I played on... We had a piano that my sister learned on momentarily, because it's a Jewish thing, isn't it, Lisa?
Everyone gets a piano.
Parents,
I think everyone.
Put you into music, is that not the case?
That's correct. I played the piano, but maybe because my great grandmother
was
had a piano.
Oh, I thought you were going to say great grandmother was.
Oh no, my grandmother used to play the piano really well, and so did my great grandmother. But we have my great grandmother's piano, so it was probably the cheapest instrument for send us to lessons for.
Yeah, well, we all played piano. I did too, from the age of five. Got my own Beale piano.
Yeah.
Not a grand, just a still weird. Have it. But I played till I was about 16 or 17 and stopped.
What was it? What was it that was
I was forced to. I had a metronome. Mum said I had to play when I came home from school for 2 hours non-stop
but
have lessons with a deaf teacher, so it was good.
But that's what I'm trying to get into. What was it? And it seems to be a recurring theme in Jewish families and that. And you go back, you watch old movies with, you know, Al Jolson and things like that. You know, the parents' desire for their children to perform musically in some way, as if, like, what? What's that?
Well, Jews have always been singing, and, you know, good times, bad times, they're always somewhere there's music. There's always something uplifting because we're always in such tragedy.
All the Yontifs have songs that you can sing as a group.
Yeah.
Yes.
We love music.
And we love liturgy. There's all that like that. That
But you, with all your multiple talents, and George, you've both been collaborating on something that we're going to talk about, which is a musical, which so many Jewish people love. We're so big in musicals. And you've also written one, is that correct? Together. Explain. Mm. Please explain.
Well, one of the loves I had when I was five was
dressing up.
Was theatre.
Don't go there.
Was theatre and television. So I've done my...
And you've worked television. in television, as we know.
I've done my television career. Now it's time for the music career.
Okay. So
musical.
What made you want to do this?
Well, I love musicals and I love dancing.
Yes.
So with those two passions...
And you rang him up.
And
you said, collaborate with me. And he said, no worries, I'll make you a coffee.
No, I walked into Barry one day with the music and I said, look, I've got this concept for a musical. This is essentially what the story's about. And I played Barry the music because we use pre-existing music. It's called a songbook musical.
With pre-existing lyrics. You're talking about songs that are already in existence.
Which are familiar to the audience.
Right.
Mm. Which Barry George, loved the music.
Which George, when he rocked up and played the music to me, he had me after this, really after this.
Dancing.
First like or second, fantastic Latin music and Guantanamera and Smooth.
Things.
Great music.
The world knows.
Which he'd already done initial research on in terms of getting the rights, because that's a huge part of being able to do it. If you want to get the rights to use the music, is a hell of a job.
Some people don't.
So after 3 years of writing together on the show, we then had an opportunity.
You wrote the actual storyline.
Correct.
Yes, the book. It's called the book.
And we're into book 22 now, which is the 22nd edition.
Right.
So an opportunity came up to do a workshop and a reading with the Australian Institute of Music called AIM in Sydney.
Which is fabulous.
Of which we did part of their curriculum, some unit work, 2 hours a week, which we slotted into their curriculum. Mm-hmm. They undertook it to do new works. Mm. So
to them it's like a reading of your...
Yeah, we're just part one, one unit part of, amongst whatever they do cabaret and they learn instruments. It's sort of like a Juilliard school in Australia.
Yes, it's very prestigious.
Like Fame.
Yes.
Yeah, sort of fame. I felt like I was in a reality show every week.
Right.
So
we've done... I don't know. Lots of fun.
Yes. So we did 10 weeks of a workshop, and this culminates at the moment. We're doing a reading, a stage reading, which we're inviting some people to have a look and see how, as an abridged and shortened version, in front of an invited audience, just to get some feedback as to what it's like in Sydney, it's like with an audience.
Given that when this happens next week, you're showing it in Sydney, that you get positive feedback, what then happens next? You know, how long will it take before something...
Who knows?
That's a $64 million question.
Really, somebody said a piece of string, you know, how long is a piece of string?
Okay.
It's as far from the middle to one end as it is to the other.
Can I just say this, people who are in your production are from AIM?
The students who are in the workshop are from AIM, and they're students in the age of 18 to 23, and they're learning to become musicians, actors, singers. The accent not that much on choreography, although, as I said to Barry, this show is a very highly choreographic piece. There are 24 songs in the show which involve choreography in a number of ways to further the narrative or further the story through the choreography, like you've got in West Side Story, or as an adjunct, as colour and movement. But again, to make our show a little bit more unique compared to other musicals.
Yeah. So we've had a lot of good feedback.
Right. So as we said, after this, you know, what would be the next step? I mean, actually getting it on stage in front of an audience, how long will that take you, do you think? If everything, let's say everything goes well.
Well, we have hopes and we have some leads, and it's possible even that the show might actually get staged in Australia sometime next year if all things go well, which it would be great if we can do
that. If it starts here, but, it's a stepping stone to elsewhere.
Otherwise, you keep on flogging it around until you can get some money and until you get something
going. Hard work, but you've done a lot of hard work thus far, and we wish you both the best.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Because you never know. And we met them here first when they become famous.
Yes. We'll never forget you people.
No, you won't, will you?
Nah.
Because we won't let you.
Nah.
We'll be back.